Okay, welcome to the fifth episode of the Collaboration Podcast. My name is Jonathan Kay, and I am here with my co-host Marco Masi, and we are members of the Sri Aurobindo Association of America, an organization that produces the Collaboration Journal and helped organize the OM Conference this past year. Collaboration, now in its 48th year of publication, is a journal dedicated to the evolutionary vision of Sri Aurobindo and the Mother. Collaboration examines the theory and practice of integral yoga, the place of humankind in the universe, and themes such as consciousness, emergence, and transformation. Articles, essays, poetry, and images explore the human impulse towards perfection and speculate on future possibilities as we move forward in a rapidly changing world.
So today with us, we have Susan Curtis. Susan is the secretary of the Sri Aurobindo Association Board and a member of SAA's Editorial Advisory Board and the Community Outreach Group. Susan was introduced to Sri Aurobindo in 1980 through Mikey Finn at the Boston Sri Aurobindo Center and Sam Spanier and Eric Hughes at of Matagiri in upstate New York. Since then, she has been practicing transpersonal clinical psychology in the mother's light, with a special focus on the psychic being as an element in the developmental and healing process in trauma. In 1999, she helped organize a conference at Matagiri called Psychology in the Light of Sri Aurobindo's Vision. It's a collaboration issue that you can find on in volume 25, number one, which would contribute to the emergence of a worldwide dialogue in integral yoga psychology. This led to her visiting then the Sri Aurobindo Ashram and Oroville in 1999 and 2002. Most recently, she has been a founding member of the rebuilt Boston Sri Aurobindo Center. She lives in Harvard, Massachusetts, near the Shaker Village, where Mother Ann Lee, vibhuti of the Mother and Shaker foundress, had her headquarters. Susan's passion is researching the Gnostic Shaker communities as evolutionary forerunners of Sri Aurobindo's collective yoga. Dear Susan, welcome to our podcast.
Thank you.
So, before we start going directly in the article of this present issue, I usually always begin with a question about yourself, about our hosts, and ask them if they can furnish some further background about them. So, usually I ask first, for example, how did you first hear about Mother and Sri Aurobindo, and how did you came to the integral yoga community?
I had a very strange introduction. I was mentoring doctoral students in a transpersonal psychology clinical program at BU in Boston, and I had a student who had met a person who actually was connected to Mikey Finn, and she wanted to do her dissertation on his realization. And she did that, and there were many twists and turns in the story. It wound up that he actually wrote the dissertation. And so in the process, I met him, and he started talking to me and to my other students about Sri Aurobindo. And within a little period of time, a group of us very interested in what he was saying joined together and we started having little ashram, weekend ashram communities. And that continued and developed to through the 80s to three different settings, and a lot of work looking at clinical endeavors in the light of Sri Aurobindo and the mother, and particularly in the light of the psychic being and the developmental aspects. So Sri Aurobindo was important to me as a link to my actual clinical work from the beginning, and the explanation of the yoga for human psychology was central from the very beginning, and for the last 40 years actually. So I hope that gives you a picture of how much in the two aspects of my career have been in invested in him and the mother.
So it came through study in the frame of your career. It
yes.
was not a okay, interesting. Okay, but then something more must have happened just then, an intellectual interest, I guess. You were engaged in this dissertation, you heard about Sri Aurobindo, but can you go perhaps a bit further than that, if I don't go into private domain here?
We began meeting with this person whose name was Juan.
Mm.
He was lecturing, teaching us about Sri Aurobindo and the mother, and we were fascinated. We read Sat Prem, Adventure of Consciousness. We started meeting every weekend, and we meditated together. We read Hymns to the Mystic Fire.
Yeah. Okay.
And we formed a little collective, actually.
Mm. Yeah. So it's exactly through the readings and through forming this collective. And usually from that, everything grows. It's very quickly. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Susan.
Yeah. Susan, could I ask a quick question just for listeners that may not be familiar with what transpersonal psychology is?
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a very important to me and my work as well. But I mean, you've done some real pioneering work, you know, in light of Haridas Chaudhry and others who have been engaging in psychology as a Western discipline and mode of knowledge production, in and finding convergences and a place in which it can share and open to the Eastern ways, which are based on fundamentally different principles. And so transpersonal psychology, I'd love to hear you speak more about that and how you're balancing this kind of East and West kind of container to hold the work that you do.
Well, transpersonal psychology allows the clinician and the client to acknowledge and validate all manner of perceptions that may be purely subjective and not verifiable by typical psychological theories and means. And it's a most expansive way of looking at the development of the individual as the psychic being begins to exert pressure on the developmental process. So I see transpersonal psychology as a way of opening to the entire possibility of the human psyche, verifiable or non-verifiable. And clinically speaking, that's extremely important because individuals do have paranormal experiences and intimations that are extremely valuable for their development and for their self-understanding. And there's a real need to open clinical practice to those possibilities. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, what I would say from the clinical perspective. Of course, there's more to that.
Yeah.
But I'm speaking today as a clinician.
Yeah, but it would be also interesting, how do we relate it to integral, because yes, I'm not a psychologist, but you know, we know that there is also this current of integral psychology, and which is inspired by the teachings of Mother Sri Aurobindo. And how do you see the relation between one and the other? I mean, between transpersonal psychology and integral psychology. Are these completely two distinct things? I'm just also asking because I myself, not being a psychologist, if someone would ask me, define integral psychology or transpersonal, I would not know where to begin with, and to have an idea how to distinguish between the two, or if there is a distinction.
Well, I'd rather talk about it in terms of how you see it in the office, and how it emerges as an orientation for the clinician who is listening carefully to a person who may feel a longing, and be drawn to certain kinds of materials, to have dreams that they can't explain, to have sensitivities to the world in general, other people, they can have certain kinds of gifts. They can be clairvoyant, for example, if you know that these are all phenomena, subjective and non-verifiable, but real phenomena that a person experiences, and also that as these things evolve, the psychic is exerting more influence. And you can begin to see this longing, sometimes sweetness, compassion, acceptance of things that have happened, a way of framing the challenges that they've had and accepting them and seeing that they could lead to a brighter future, and a real healing in the traumatic reprocessing. It's very powerful, but it's very tangible also.
This is transpersonal psychology you're yes, talking about? Yes. Yeah, okay. Yeah. And how would you relate this kind of approach in psychology to what is called integral psychology? Because as I understand it, they are very different, two different things. Integral psychology is more based on Sri Aurobindo's and Mother's writings, whereas transpersonal, but as I understand it, there are a lot of connections. There are also a lot of things that they have in common. I just wanted to have an intuitive feeling, if it is possible, if it doesn't go too far in technical questions, how transpersonal psychology and integral psychology relate to each other, if at all. I don't know.
Well, maybe Jonathan can parse those technical descriptions better than I can. I would say that transpersonal psychology is an overall term, and I would say that integral psychology is the most expansive explanation of that term. And it brings in all the elements that are possible in the human experience. And I haven't studied, transpersonal perspectives in years in other than Sri Aurobindo and the mother. So maybe Jonathan, if you want to add something, because you're in the hotbed at CIIS.
Right. Yeah. Well, I could just add, without going into too much detail, But I could add that transpersonal psychology is really an open field. It's still relatively new compared to, you know, other types of disciplines of kind of Western knowledge production. But it's really, it was founded out of exactly the problems and, you know, the problems that Susan, you mentioned. And I think that it's really more of an open question that it clearly has a foot in science and in psychology, but it's also looking to not accept the assumptions of Western psychology. It's looking to problematize, it's looking to bring in other modes of knowing, like you had mentioned. It's looking to critically examine how we have assumed certain things about the nature of the psyche from before Freud and onwards, the nature of the unconscious, for instance. And so when we open those questions up and say, well, maybe Freud was onto something, but are we done dealing with the nature of X or Y? Maybe Jung was onto something, maybe he was very, you know, opening up some of Freud's ideas in very resonant ways for somebody and allowing different modalities to come through, like expressive arts and imaginal work and things like that. And the question continues, you know, so I think that that's a really important aspect of transpersonal psychology. And I don't think that, you know, you could get into the nitty gritty of what defines transpersonal psychology. But as soon as you fix yourself to a definition, you may be actually leaving out these other types of possibilities that are still not yet able to be formulated into language. And so I think it's kind of like there's one foot in the Western knowledge academy in a way, and in psychology and science, but then there's one foot in like in holding that experiential and the more of the subjective side and really trying to bring these two so that they can actually help each other in a way. And so that one doesn't overdetermine the other. So if one would overdetermine the other, you go to a psychologist, yeah, and then they may reduce your experience to say, oh, well, you're just experiencing this. I know what it is because I'm the doctor. I've studied this, mm-hmm, and I'm an expert. Whereas it's like, well, maybe they might be getting to something, but is it also undermining an experience that goes beyond what you can express, you know? And so I think that you know, yoga, yeah, for instance, is a whole other metaphysical container, a whole other epistemology. It presents a whole other way of knowing yourself and your relation to the others, relation to nature, relation to cosmos, relation to the divine. And so I think that, like you had said, Marco, they actually in the hands of people that are working at this, mm-hmm, intersection, then both of these are overlapping in certain degrees. There's certain ways in which you need them to overlap so that an integral, yeah, integral psychology, for instance, is a part of the discourse of transpersonal psychology, but it may not be accepted by everybody in that field. Yeah. And so it's kind of finding ways in which they can speak to each other without, yeah, reducing one to the other. And I mean, even it gets, you know, it gets more, it can become more complicated because integral psychology is a word, is a term that has a history. Now, integral yoga psychology is a different term that has a different history. And so, you know, I believe Indra Sen was one that kind of coined based on Sri Aurobindo's, his learning from Sri Aurobindo, but like that would be integral psychology. Debashish Banerjee released a book called Integral Yoga Psychology. And so it's not that they're fundamentally different, but they're kind of, I guess they're bringing out different nuances of this conversation, you know?
So we can say that they are building bridges. So it's sort of where transpersonal psychology is a bridge, perhaps, between the classical Western analytic psychology, psychoanalytic psychology, and a more Eastern view of the human being and the psyche. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And there, of course, it connects also with integral yoga and integral psychology. Yes. Okay.
Well, this has been great because I know Susan, having you here on the podcast, really being able to bring out your expertise and your deep experience in this, and you know how you've added to this conversation is really in bringing these two things together: transpersonal psychology, integral psychology, and yoga.
Exactly.
It's really great to delve into that with you. Now, shall we switch over to our other topic of conversation? Which is a fantastic article that you wrote in this collaboration. This version is out. People should have it in their hands. And if you are watching this video and you don't, then please go to the website and you can actually subscribe to it. This is called The American Soul, volume 47, number 3, from fall and winter 2022-2023. And your article, The Shakers, Gift for the American Soul. And this was just a fascinating article. It really, for me, it opened, it just, it was inspiring. It was really kind of an opening. It opened my heart up in a way because I really resonated with a lot of how you shared your experience and interaction with this community, because you're from that area, actually. And so you're embedded also in having a kind of a close relation to this culture, this community. But I also really appreciated how you related it to the kind of the bigger questions of the contemporary times. You know, the question of individualism versus collectivity, the question of technology comes up, the role of the arts of expression. I think there's just so many big questions that you really brought out and helped I think me see how the Shakers have been undergoing their own, I mean, building their own culture, not accepting the terms and conditions of, you know, what we could call the modern or modernity. And I think that's very inspiring. So I was just wondering if you could just share a little bit about writing this article and about your experience with this culture and how you came to write this article.
Well, it's kind of interesting because I had experiences that would not be acknowledged in Western psychology. And that's what drew me in, and it's really a surprise. I moved to Harvard in 2001, so after I'd been to the ashram in Oroville, and my house was 2 miles from Mother Ann's headquarters, and I didn't know the area, and so when I first moved here, I started exploring, you know, the hills and dales of the town. And I went into the area, which was the sacred ground of the Shakers in the mid-19th century, in the 1840s, their ritual area where they would go to have ceremonies and prayers and so forth. And I was wandering around. I didn't know where I was. And all of a sudden, I heard singing and a sort of a clanking of, you know, people walking along, pails clanking and so forth. But the singing, I thought, that's really strange. And I started looking around, and no one was there. And I realized that what I had done was begun walking on the path that was the path that the central Shaker village used to come to this ritual site. But it was a formation. Mm-hmm. And that certainly drew me in. And after that, I went to the nearby Fruitlands Museum, where there was a Shaker building. And when I went into the building, all of a sudden, it was like entering a shower of Shakti, this emanation coming down over the threshold of the building, and it was sweet, it was powerful, it created a vibration of Shakti. It was quite amazing. And I thought, what has happened here? How did this happen? And then I realized that Mother Ann's chair was on a landing up above the doorway. And it was emanating this vibration, this spiritual vibration. And I thought, well, is this me or is this her? What is this? And I've traveled around to a number of different villages, and people universally talk about Mother Ann's chair and its impact. So Mother Ann was a person who, because of her own evolution, development, what you have you, could permeate an object with her vibration. And this permeation lasted over 200 years. This is very powerful. What is this about? So that really fueled the beginning of the investigation. And I joined with a number of other people who investigate Shaker provenance chiefly. And I realized that Mother Ann's spiritual development was followed the classical experience of intense longing, intense focus, isolation, inner visions, and then a final emergence of a different identity. And the testimonies of things that she said and the effect that she had on people around her absolutely validate that kind of description. And her final conversion actually happened probably in jail. And so if that tied me to Sri Aurobindo, another jailbird has an incredible awakening. So that really cemented it for me. And then I began looking into all the aspects I could about the Shakers and her development and what she brought and her teachings and so forth.
That reminds me also a bit of the experience that I had when I went to the samadhi at the ashram. There also you feel very clearly that the Shakti is very present and it's very powerful. And it's, by the way, I could say that in some rare cases you can find this also, I don't know, in the US, but also in some European churches. Mm-hmm. It's incredible in a certain sense. I don't say why, but there are still some points, because when I go in some churches, most of them feel somehow dry, cold, spiritually dry and cold. Mm-hmm. But there are some spots of light here and there where you can feel there is. And I had also some occasion to know then the people who are living there, how do you say, priests, you can see clearly that it is also because there is someone that is bringing this Shakti, even if it's in a completely different context. But how far can we say, because this is still, you use the word sect, which mm-hmm. I don't know, you use the word sect to describe them, which I don't know how far this is, because in my language, the sect has a negative connotation, but I obviously think it's not, as you have it in your article. But the question is, how does the sect or this organization or this spiritual movement, how far did it survive to our modern times? So how many people are there? How much do you feel it has an impact in our modern society, or at least in this frame in Harvard or surroundings, Massachusetts? Or is it, so I guess it's not something that is dying out. It's still very, very strong there, But also at the level of organization, are there still many people participating to it, or just your feeling? And I'm not asking to quantify it, but how much is it your perception that it still survives and affects the life of people today? And how do you see this organization going on in the future?
Well, it's interesting that when President Obama was inaugurated, he evoked the Shakers as the core kind of tradition that expressed the best American values. Mm-hmm. The Shakers believe in evolution, and so they have gracefully moved from being in communities to creating locations in the old villages that can teach the Shaker ways. There are now, I think, three actually covenanted Shakers who have joined and given everything over into their village, and they are in Maine at Sabbath Day Lake. But around the villages, there are a number of people who support the Shakers monetarily. There's a lot of interest in museums and preserving the heritage, particularly the physical heritage. There's a huge museum that's going to be built in central New York to house all the provenance that's been collected. Collectors are very interested, and Shaker goods are valuable. So there's the actual interest in the Shakers has shifted to the things that they produced, and the music and the art. And what is a concern of mine is that the true spiritual depth of what they actually had from Mother Anne's person, from all that she embodied, has really shifted and changed, and it's less that. I think people are less aware of that than they are of the things that were produced from that emanation. So
Did she write books? She was illiterate.
She knew her Bible, but she never wrote. So we know of her through the people who testified about her and remembered some of the things that she said. But as we know from people who ever met the mother, it's an experience that stays with you. It can be totally transformative. And in the testimonies that were collected by the Shakers, individuals recount these meetings, the things she said, the impact that they had on her, and she had on them, I should say. And those, to me, ring true. They absolutely ring true. And you think of the wonderful series that Fred Sobran did on the pioneers of Oroville, and their first meeting with the mother. And that describes strictly what people felt when they met Mother Anne. It was transformative.
Interesting analogy.
And quickly, what sent her to jail? I'm interested in.
She had a method of worship that she and her followers did. They were, I think they actually were probably impacted greatly in their meetings by her realization and what she emanated. And the worship was totally different from what was acceptable in England at the time in the churches. And people, they sang, they danced, They twirled, they shouted, they spoke in tongues, and they made a lot of noise. And so the churches and the people around them, and the magistrates felt they were violating the peace. And so they would put them bring them into jail. The other thing was that she had, as I say in my article, a real thing about carnal nature, about all the arrangements that stem from the marriage relation and the position of women and the general suffering that those kinds of relationships and structures created for people. And she was actually talking about more than sex and the sexual relation. The carnal relation to her was really wanting to have things for oneself, one's desire nature. And that was seen as sin, separation from wanting things for God and turning to God. So when she talked about lust, she was talking about desire in all its forms that took a person away from serving God, from the principles of Christ. And that's what she was seeing. And her own experiences growing up in a crowded household with a number of adults in various kinds of relations, and the fact that she married and had four children who died in infancy and early, by the age of six. So she had the full experience of the pain of those relationships. So a lot of what she said had to do with exactly with that, but it was a much larger perception and concern.
In your article, it is also mentioned about you make connections with a different view of nature, of natural resources they had, and what you already mentioned a bit, the relationship. They were abolitionists. Mm-hmm. They were for the parity of men and women. And yeah, so they connect much more to our modernity nowadays than at those times, I guess. My question is, did they have some connection? Did they also have an relationship with indigenous people eventually? Or was this,
Particularly when they first established their village in Watervliet, which they called Niskayuna. But their viewpoint, the way they saw the life around them, was really because the consciousness that Mother Anne possessed was cosmic. Was cosmic. So she was perceiving the world around her from the central being and the inner being, and the influence she had on other people around her because of what she emanated brought other people into their inner nature. And so the outer arrangement reflected that perception.
Yeah.
And it was totally different from the genocide of the animals that was going on and all the cruelty towards indigenous people. It was truly a very different perspective.
It shows also that it's not so much about knowledge, intellectual knowledge, because you say she was even illiterate, no? But she had this sensibility that is very needed nowadays, especially when we think at the environmental issues and so on. and that people who are very intelligent and smart don't understand, but other people who live in this cosmic consciousness, for them it's absolutely obvious and self-evident. They don't need books to understand why it is detrimental for ourselves to destroy nature and to have this genocides and violence between human beings among themselves.
It seems like a just such an inspiring example of spirituality as opposed to religion, because she was a heretic. Like she was put in jail because people felt she wasn't acting normal, and being a normal human is like being a human depends on what it means. You know, who defines what a human is, for instance? Well, obviously the slave Africans aren't humans, so therefore we can, you know, so coming from this European logic, she's a settler in the New World, as you call it in the article, but she was definitely a heretic to the religion at the time, but like being following the spirit, you know, like, and that spirit is not necessarily, it's not found only in a church or only, it's not mediated through the priestly classes who can translate what is acceptable and what is normal and what you must do. And I just think it's just she was a visionary, a mystic, a heretic, and in terms of another important concept, she was an activist to the core, it sounds like to me, you know. And I think that's why this story is so relevant. And thinking about back in those days, going against the mainstream and going against the church so strongly, I can't imagine the struggles that all forms of really activism take. But I think, you know, obviously that spiritual energy, the Shakti, the force, you know, was obviously so, it must have been so just all pervading to sustain this activism on so many levels. And like, you know, even the idea of celibacy, you know, it's not just celibacy for the sake because some scripture said that through celibacy you will gain a certain realization. It's like, no, there was a political motivation. It's like the subjugation of women and the fact that our society is based on an unhealthy relationships of desire. And I think that's one good example of activism. And you know this idea of being in isolation, like sort of these communities having a very conscious, not closed, because you also bring up that they were technologically astute, they were entrepreneurs. So I think that idea of being very strategic in how you engage with this outside world, and that's something. These are all things that I'm dealing with in my own life, in my own sadhana. This idea of how can we find the difference between, or how can we build, some philosophers use the idea of a we versus a they, and really separating out and saying, I don't necessarily accept all of the ways in which this society, all of the assumptions, I mean, all of the conscious, but even unconscious assumptions that this society is built on, like the status of the human, for instance, like the status of nature is there for us to do what we want with it. So again, like this kind of, there's an ecological holism involved in this. There's a spirit that's pervading the earth, the world, the sky. I mean, it just sounds like it's really bringing the divinity into an immanent relationship. And I just think this is all so relative, you know, to in these days. I just wanted to bring some of those ideas out, and I really, really thank you for sharing this community, this with us, this culture. You know, I live now in an area in Canada where we have Mennonites, which are related to Quakers. But you know, it's to me, it whenever I see them in their carts, the horse-drawn carts, I see the craftsmanship of the what they produce, and they do sell in this area. It just, there's something, there's a big question. It opens up me to these big questions to say, I assume that everybody drives around in a car. You just assume that this how the world works. But as soon as you see somebody doing that, and I've always found it much more of an invitation than it's anything that makes me feel insecure. Maybe people might be like, oh, well, I feel insecure because they're choosing not to do what I do. Does that mean they don't agree with what I'm doing? There's a way in which you can kind of project into this situation a very unhealthy dynamic. And I think that it's, for me, it's always been more of an invitation to say, oh yeah, just a reminder. You don't have to assume any of this. You don't have to assume the political system that you're in. You don't have to assume power relationships that don't work for you. You don't have to assume that we have to drive gas guzzling vehicles all over the place. And it's more of an invitation to consider otherwise and build another type of world. And it seems like, yeah, it seems, Marco, your question is along the lines of like, how is this community now? Is a very, it's an interesting one as well. And how are they navigating that boundary that they've created? How strict do they feel they need to be in order to maintain that what their goals? How can we realize our goals, which are spiritual goals? And how much do we need to engage with, you know, contemporary capitalism to fulfill those goals and not get caught up in the stories and games that it kind of imposes on us?
And that's what's fascinating. You think of them as being very evolutionary. And now the vehicle that they're using and getting support from the larger world, from the political world, is the museum. And there's a great deal of investment in building, restoring the Shaker villages and teaching through them the different way of actually interacting, the different values a chief thing that they're doing has to do with the herbalism that was a real part of what they produced, the seed businesses and the tinctures and the various uses they had for plants. And now these museums are revitalizing their herb gardens. There's an exquisite one in Water Vliet, one of the most beautiful I've seen. And it's really expressing the alternative to the pharmaceutical approach to wellness. And it's a very promising thing because the Shakers in their time were masters of that realm. So they're continuing to have an influence that way and an alternative and an inspiration. As you say, we don't have to be subject to the conditions of the larger culture. So
there is, however, the fundamental question now that comes to my mind that perhaps, I don't know, we should have asked this at the beginning, or perhaps not, I don't know. After all, you have published an article in a journal dedicated to the yoga of Sri Aurobindo and Mother. And then the natural question for, you already wrote about this in the article, but I ask this question also for our viewers who have not read the article. Okay, that's all fine and well, but what has this to do with Sri Aurobindo and Mother? Why do you see a connection between their way of life or their vision and that of integral yoga? How far? Yes, no, partially. So there is a motivation, I think, behind this in publishing such an article about such an interesting movement. But okay, you already said they had an evolutionary vision, so I think this is one point. Can you perhaps go deeper into this aspect and say why you see the connection?
So the Shakers longed to create a community that was devoted and expressed human unity. And if you look at the things that Auroville has in its
charter,
Auroville is like a Shaker Village on steroids. And the difference is really interesting, that the Shaker communities, because of the kind of people that were drawn, many of them were illiterate and certainly not worldly, and certainly not had no access to the universal situation that we have. They used outer means to help people focus inwardly. So everything in the Shaker community was aimed at focusing the mind on God. And so there was this structure of support. And if I understand Auroville at all, and where the mother was seeing the necessity of human development going, there had to be this complete inner freedom to meet that possibility in all the different ways that one might actually have. So instead of an outer structure, there was this, in Auroville, there's an intense inner freedom and universality. And that seems to me the next evolution from the principles that the Shakers expressed into how you meet those, how you create those with this in complete freedom. I think Auroville is technologically very, very much in the line of the Shakers. Every new possibility is being explored and established and investigated, and that's exactly what the Shakers were doing too with the material world.
So you see that the type of collective life, you see parallels between Auroville and their collective life of the Shakers. Yeah, interesting.
They were all bent. They're bent on the same, on realizing the same material perfection. Let's put it that way: the divine life on Earth.
Okay, they use these words, the divine life on Earth, or how did they express it in this kind of? Interesting.
The divine life was envisioned as the teachings of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
But I think as avatars go, that's about as clear a call for human behavior among humans and the world at large as has ever been transmitted from the higher realms. So they had their finger on the pulse of that, for sure.
Were there also connections, just quick, something very quick question and answer, were there also connections with the Gnostic Christianity? Do you see some parallel there, or is they didn't mention this?
The idea was to live the Gnostic.
The Gnostic. Because
that was very consciously in their viewpoint, and the early Christian history of that and effort of that was very much in their view.
Yeah.
Yeah, it seems Great. It seems again like it's falling. A lot of the mystical traditions are those that are on the periphery of a mainstream, I mean, or even a mystical mystical seers, yogis, visionaries, they start to effectuate change within people, and then sometimes those become a religion, or sometimes the religious, the more institutionalized aspects start to normalize and codify, and it seems like balancing that in community, that openness, that idea of like there's an inner knowing, there's an inner spirit that can communicate, that is all that's here, that's rather than I think that's the kind of that's this is again where that is such a beautiful convergence of politics and spirituality. Like they have to go together. You can't have one without the other, because of the consequences. Is if you consider spirituality without politics, it can very easily turn into something that subjugates others as you try to convince them of your definition or your methods of spirituality. And so I think it's yes, you mentioned Orville is again trying to, it's an experiment in finding that line. How can this be opened to the divine, to the new, to that creative Shakti? At the same time, how can it be maintain a very conscious relationship to things like the outside world, in the sense of the outside world is full of forces that may not serve that goal, that shared aspiration. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to read a couple of paragraphs here from the end of your article. Is that okay? Because I think they're really fitting because we're coming to the end of the podcast. So here you say, as a nation, if we had been more guided by the beliefs and practices of the indigenous peoples and the Shakers, the enormous divide challenging the American people now might not have come about. We might not have interpreted liberty and the pursuit of happiness as a purely white male prerogative to take unchecked the seemingly endless abundance of the new world. The nature of these ideals secretly harbored a tyrannical brutality and the right to control and dominate all other aspects of creation, including women, for their use and pleasure. This resulted in the genocide of indigenous people and dishonest dealings with them, the continuation and intensification of slavery, the mistreatment and control of women, and the destruction of the natural environment. In the Shakers, we have an example of a group of people who believe the divine could manifest and be a living reality on the physical plane. And in this, they are closer to the spirituality of America's indigenous people than to most contemporary American religious traditions. Native American traditions recognize that great spirit is present everywhere in everything. I just thought that was a very powerful couple paragraphs. Yeah. So, Marco, if you have any last questions or comments.
No, perhaps I can forward this question to Susan. If you have something to add, is there something you feel that we didn't ask you and you wanted we asked you? If there's some aspect that you want to highlight or whatever?
Well, I think we've used the word vibhuti, but to me it's extremely wonderful to realize that great souls have manifested in the American on the American land. You know, you go to India, it's the playground of great souls. And certainly colonial America was not. And I think America in general is not the playground of great souls. And Mother Anne was a great soul and made a great contribution. And she was an emanation of the mother.
Yeah.
In our land. And that is, to me, that's mystical, magical, marvelous.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I think the one other thing that I wanted to bring out as well is the importance of bringing out kind of histories of America that are not the normative, not the normal, the mainstream. And building histories that are in resonance and can help support different goals, different that can help open us to different metaphysical containers and different ways of engaging, like we're talking about, with the earth, with the spirit. And I think that this is a really, you know, even, you know, you rightly mentioned how Obama you know, for a good reason, brought them into the narrative. And I think that that's that idea of really finding for ourselves an alternative narratives that we can kind of help to reconstruct and help to empower a new future. And this is really a part of that. And I thank you for that.
Yeah, beautiful. Beautiful, Susan.
Yeah.
Pleasure talking about this and trying to clarify it for the audience.
You know, so it's also amazing how I at least discover every time new jewels, new diamonds, and that I didn't say, why? How is it that nobody speaks about these things? Because this is so powerful, so you can feel that there is a spirit in there. And yeah, I don't know, I don't have an answer to this, but every time I'm surprised that especially powerful messages still struggle to come through, and perhaps, but they will. And this is one of those who might also form our future, or at least part of the US or Massachusetts, I don't know, of the part of the collective. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I would say.
Thanks, you too. Yeah, it's been a great conversation. Thanks, Susan, for being with us. Thanks, Marco, for all the great questions. And we'll see you both soon.
Thank you, Susan. Thanks, Jonathan. Have a nice time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.